Not many can say they had a better Saturday night than Christopher Luxon. The former Air New Zealand chief executive is now poised to go from running one of the biggest companies in New Zealand to running the whole country. He held a long strategy meeting at his home yesterday where no doubt the discussion included how to work out a deal with ACT and probably New Zealand first. Prime Minister-elect Christopher Luxon joins me this morning. Morena. Prime Minister-elect, well done. Congratulations. You must be delighted.
Oh, look, absolutely. It was a fun evening, but more importantly, you get very focused very quickly on the opportunity to actually take the country forward, and that's why we have campaigns, and it feels like the end of a long job interview, to be honest, and now we've got a real job and we go to work and really get things done for the New Zealand people.
So what was discussed at that meeting yesterday?
Look, I mean, really three things. The first is that there's 570,000 special votes that still need to be counted. That'll take up to the 3rd of November before we have complete clarity on the election result. There's a lot of dynamics at play potentially in the special votes that could be different or similar from what we've seen in the past. The second thing is that we do want to use the 3 weeks to actually progress the relationship and start conversations around arrangements with respective parties, and that process will kick on. I'm not going to do that as per normal, as I've observed in recent elections in New Zealand, where it's a very much a blow-by-blow done through the media. We're going to do that privately. We'll do that constructively and professionally with each of the parties. And then thirdly, there's a bunch of work really around the transition and making sure that we have a very smooth transition, and Chris Hipkins and the Labor government outgoing have been very good at also reaching out already, and our teams are in close concert around actually things that have that are, you know, in between two governments really that we need to be consulted on. And so I want to make sure that's a very smooth transition as well.
Pulling up on those first 2 points, the special votes and how you actually get to the next step of forming that government, that is a substantial chunk of votes. And history would say, although we can't count on it, that you're probably going to need another seat at least, and that will probably mean you're going to have to look at talking to Winston in New Zealand first. Have you spoken to him yet?
Look, our teams have spoken, but again, I'm not going to go into that because, in fairness, as I said on the night, I want to work respectfully with each of the political parties that are involved. We're going to form a strong, stable government. That's really important.
And are you going to do that before the special votes are counted, or are you going to have to wait until the special votes?
Well, we ultimately have to wait, for we've got clarity out of the special votes.
You know, so you think you're going to lose probably another seat at least?
Well, I'm not sure, but I mean, the point is we can hypothesise about the special votes, we can talk about overhangs, that those are the factors at play that will ultimately shape what happens. But at the end of the day, there's still 3 weeks, and actually we need to keep moving forward, and actually we can progress, you know, certainly building the relationships. I'm a big person, having done a lot of negotiations in my life, that if you've got a good, strong relationship and chemistry, then you can actually work through the transactional issues on top of that.
If you do lose a seat and you would need New Zealand first, they've suddenly got a lot more leverage or a lot more bargaining power. Isn't it in your best interest to form a government now with ACT before you need New Zealand first?
Again, we're going to work that through with the respective parties. And I know that's a different approach from what we've seen in the past, but actually, to be honest, the blow-by-blow doing negotiations through the media is not something that I'm up for. In fairness, I want to have a strong relationship with coalition partners. I think we can do that, but I want to progress that with those leaders.
When is it important to you then to start finding out what their boundaries are or what they're willing to compromise on? Does that happen before or after those votes?
That's the conversation that we can get into in the next 3 weeks. Okay. And that's what I want to progress. And so, you know, there's a lot that we can progress and use the time for until we have certainty on our election result. It is unfortunate. I think you said it's like, you know, what is it? What did you say? Hurry up and wait.
Yep.
And I think that's a very apt description of it, because essentially it is, you know, like we want to get moving and we want to get going, and we know we've got a great country and we've got to go to work for New Zealanders, but actually we've got to get our result confirmed first. And when you've got 570,000 votes still to be counted, it's important we have that clarity. But in the intervening period, let's get clear on building the relationship, getting clear on the, you know, ground rules, getting clear on issues that are important to the respective parties, and start progressing.
Okay. How many seats realistically do you think you're going to lose when those special votes come in?
Difficult to say. There's a number of scenarios. And again, the special votes this time, you know, will be interesting, because historically it's people that may have moved location and as a result of either registered on the day or are voting outside of their electorate.
They lean left, right, because it's usually students who
often it's
are
renters,
in a place that
you know, and they might
area.
Be younger, yep. And they might tend to lean more left, as you'd say. But on the other side, we've got an awful lot of people that are out travelling, watching rugby in Europe. We've got other dynamics at play as well. So, you know, look, at the end of the day, we can speculate and hypothesise about all of that. The great thing is there was a vote for change. We're going to work with the parties for change. And we'll do that in a very constructive, positive way.
Looking at your 100-day plan, covers fuel tax, three waters, gang patches, banning cell phones, speed limits. There was nothing specific that I saw on the list that focused only on the number one issue for voters, the cost of living?
Look, I think there is. I mean, we've got to be able to deliver tax relief to low and middle income New Zealanders. We talked about that. We need to get through the wasteful spending that we're seeing in government and get moving.
Those are not 100-day plans, though. What's in your first 100 days for the cost of living?
Well, I mean, those are things that we're going to get working on. You know, be clear about it. There's some things that require regulation and legislation and other things that don't. And so we're going to be moving very quickly through that. But
3 months, though, in the first 3 months?
Well, I mean,
everyone's going to the supermarket once a week?
Yeah, we've got an ambitious program, and that's really important because, you know, we have to get this country turned around now. We've got a great future, but we've now got to go to work and actually get rid of red tape. We've got to make sure that we get rid of the wasteful spending, actually give people tax relief, get to the causes of inflation, get inflation down, get the interest rates down, get the economy growing again.
So you're just hoping that the cost of living decreases as a byproduct of those, but they are all slightly longer term. If you're going to spend the next 21 days or so negotiating
No, I disagree with you, because actually when you say cost of living, it's a big broad term, right?
It is.
What that means is inflation.
But for most people, it's the cost of their groceries when they go to the supermarket.
Sure, exactly right. But they want
to see relief now.
Correct, but the underlying cause of that is actually inflation, and what we have to do is tackle those causes of inflation. That's what we're going to do.
When you talk about reviewing the Reserve Bank's mandate and getting them focused back on reducing inflation, do you not think they've been doing that?
Again, what we mean by that is that the mandate was expanded. It was what's called a dual mandate. We want it single-mindedly focused back on fighting inflation.
Do you think that's been a distraction for the bank?
As I've said before, we felt that there, with respect to the bank, there are a number of actions that probably were taken that actually could have made the cost of living actually worse. That's why we've asked for a review around their actions. But importantly, we need to get focused back on fighting inflation. It's our number one challenge that we have. If we can get inflation down, we can remove the pain that people are experiencing, their mortgage payments, rent, fuel, food as well. Those are the big costs that people are struggling with, and that's why we've got to deal with inflation.
Having a review, though, and then putting them down to a single mandate seems to imply that you don't believe they've been focused enough on tackling inflation.
Well, again, we just had a view that, you know, moving and expanding their mandate, we don't want any distractions. We want them, when we have price stability and when we have inflation below 3%, preferably at 2%, it gives the country and the economy massive certainty. People know that they can make that investment. That gives them, you know, they can grow. There's a whole bunch of consequences. People can, you know, we just need to focus on inflation. That's the number one task for us.
Okay, we've got a couple of viewer questions. Aisha says, are you still going to raise the retirement age?
Yeah, but the question is, we're going to do that, as we said in the campaign, from 2044 to 2046. And the reason's very simple, that is every decade, New Zealanders live another year and a half longer.
Is that going to be enough to placate Winston Peters?
Again, I'm not getting into any of that, because we will have those conversations with the respective parties as we put together a serious, solid government that actually can deal with the challenges that New Zealand has. But, you know, our policy has been very clear to say we've got to give people lots of time to adjust, but, you know, we're talking 2044.
Have you started considering who you would give certain portfolios to?
Again, those are considerations that will come through the conversations with the respective parties and as we think that through. So,
in your own cabinet?
Look, yes, we've got some fantastic talent and some wonderful people in roles, but again, we'll work all of that out as we go through our you know, we're in an MMP environment, as I said before the campaign. The people of New Zealand are never wrong. They deliver a result on an election night. We now go to town and make it work, and we make sure we get strong, stable government.
Would you give Winston Peters the foreign portfolio?
Again, just not getting into any of that. And I appreciate this is the game that goes on, the parlour game that happens.
I'll ask and you can give whatever answer you want.
You can keep asking, and I'm just going to keep giving you the same answer, which is, in fairness, out of goodwill, I want to build a strong government. And for that to happen, I don't think it's helped by us doing negotiations through the media.
Would the same apply then to your answer on David Seymour wanting finance?
Again, same answer.
Okay. Yep. And what
I'm sorry it's going to be but it's actually a different approach, because I genuinely feel it's actually really important. You know, we have some serious issues to face up to. I want to do this respectfully. I want to build goodwill with the respective parties that we want to work with.
How long
get a strong platform
let
in place.
Those negotiations go on? If it really, I mean, it's not going to be an easy job. I don't think anyone expects it to be an easy job. They perhaps put faith in you that you can do it. How long will you let those negotiations go on for?
Well, they'll take as long as they need to take to get it done, but I will be working with great speed. That's why I'm organising now. That's why we're going to work to progress the relationships and arrangements in the next 3 weeks with the respective parties. We will move at the rates that they want to work with as well. We will also make sure we're cognizant of those special votes that come in on the 3rd of November. But look, we're going to make sure we have a government that's actually acting in New Zealand's interests, and I think those other party leaders are in the same place.
Okay, I just want to quickly get to one more viewer question. question. Your salary and said, what will you, we've talked a lot about, I've seen you in the debates talking about the cost of an orange and perhaps Chris Hipkins going around with a clipboard checking the prices. Your salary wants to know what you will do to break up the supermarket duopoly.
Look, what we've got is we've got a new grocery commissioner, which we supported. We certainly support the code of conduct. I've worked in the grocery sector overseas. We've had very concentrated markets, say, in the UK and other places. Those two things, if you give them proper teeth, can have real impact.
Does that duopoly need to be broken up?
Well, again, we need to actually make sure we implement the actions that have already been taken, which we've been supportive of. Let's see how they go before we jump to a conclusion that any other alternative is in place.
You would look at further steps?
Part of it is things like, for example, if you are a third player supermarket chain globally and you have 195 countries around the world to think about whether you launch operations into, some of what we do in New Zealand doesn't make it very attractive for those companies to come and make an investment. The overseas investment office process is poor and slow. The resource consenting process is poor and slow. And so as a result, they sit there and go, well, no problem. I don't need to put my money into New Zealand. I'll go put it into Australia or Indonesia or somewhere else in the world. So there's a lot of things, factors at play in terms of how you actually make sure there's a competitive market. Yes, it needs to be a competitive market. Yes, we've got the Commerce Commission and the Grocery Commissioner involved. Yes, we've got a new code of conduct. We should see how they go and we give them real teeth. And if it doesn't work, we'll do more.
One last question, just before we go, and it's going to be a brief one. Elon Musk has congratulated you on X, formerly known as Twitter. Do you know him personally?
I don't know him personally.
Have you ever met him?
No.
Okay. Yeah. Great. All right. Prime Minister-elect Christopher Luxon, thank you for coming
in this morning.
Thanks
so much. Appreciate it.